my work, what I have done. So I will try to be very simple so that we have a good interpretation about it. So I will talk about first detector simulation and how we go from detector simulation to data analysis in high energy physics experiments. So let's see, this is why. Since we have many talks about the concept of detector, so we used detector for the charge particle detection. So when we have an incident charge particle, it lose the energy loss inside the detector, and we got electron hole pairs and all electron ion pairs, which we basically detect as a signal. This is how we detect a particle inside the detector. Now the question is, can we also tell the particle type of the particle? So for this, let's understand first the energy loss inside the material, which is given by the Bethe-Bloch formula. So I plotted the for different particles as a function of momentum, this Bethe-Bloch formula in the silicon, this thickness. So let's say if we get the signal inside the detector corresponds to 5150 keV, which I shown by the dotted line. So it can be any particle like this. You can see it can be proton also, it can be kaon also, these all possibilities are there. So if we want to tell the type of particle, energy deposited is not enough. You have to also require a momentum. Then you can exactly locate the which is the particle. So we need to determine the momentum to tell the particle type also. Now the determination of momentum. So since we have a charged particle in the magnetic field, we know that it experiences the Lorentz force when charged particle passes. We have the magnetic field here, and then the charged particle passes. It follows the helical trajectory. So in the cylindrical coordinate, this helix will be, if you project on the XY plane, it will be a circle, and you can easily determine the PT by measuring the radius of curvature. So I shown this how it comes from this formula in the backup, and in the RZ plane, it will be a straight line. So I just also shown here. So we can measure the lambda by fitting the tracks in the RZ plane by straight line, and we can determine the track parameters on the each detector plane. So for example, if you take a track here and it's passing through the four detectors, so X, Y position we can get from the fired pixels or PET, or and the Z position from the position of the detectors, as it has some position, Z position. And then we can measure the Px, Py, Pz using these formulas. Once we have X, Y, Z position and fitting of the tracks, we have the radius, and then we can determine the track parameters and each detector plane. Now, so previous, yes. So now the to measure the radius of curvature, like if we have got the 2 points, you will just have the straight line fit. You don't have the curvature. So for the measure the to measure the radius, we should have at least 3 points. So we need at least three detectors to reconstruct the track trajectory. So now the question comes, how many layers we required, and what is the position of layers, and what is the error in the radius or momentum measurement? So for this, let's consider that we use the detector. We can determine this precisely by using the detector simulation. So the main idea will be here. If we have this detector setup, for example, D1, D2, D3, D4, and if we want to determine whether our detector is working for the particle determination or not, then what we will do, we will throw a known charge particle. We know everything about that particle, and if we can reconstruct the same particle with similar momentum, which we call the PX-RECO, then we can say our setup is working, detector setup is working. So let's say if we have Monte Carlo track, it's two tracks, which will give the 2 points on the detector plane. You can see that here. And these are the RECO points, which we reconstructed from the signals inside the detector. And then you have the RECO track. So since we know that if we measure something with our usual scales, we have always the error, which is basically least count here. Here we are measuring the positions from the pixels. So this least count depends on the size of the pixels, these error. So these error will always be propagated in the reconstruction of position, which we call usual position resolutions. And then this, once we have the error in the position also, we will also have the error in the radius of radius measurement, which ultimately reflected in the momentum resolution. There is also one part, multiple scattering. I will come later on it. So the main idea is to you have to reduce these errors as much as possible. But we always want the errors as small as possible. So now we have to check this setup. We need first charged particles, then we need a detector geometry, and then we need interaction of particle with the material. So we need a particle generator, and then the rest of the work GIANT4 can do it. Now I will take my example, what I did in on the TPC simulation, which this is a C is the one of the experiment is going to be built at IMP CS China, where I did this work. So I will not go to the detail of the experiment, just I will want to mention there's a one detector, which is a TPC, which works as a tracking detector. So I worked on that. So this is the concept of that. It is in the form of rectangular box. It includes the P10 gas. We have a high voltage plane, and then we have a pad plane, and we have a jam plane here. So when a charged particle passes through the inside the TPC volume, it creates the ionization, and then these ionization electrons and ions, electrons will drift towards the jam plane and will make the amplification in the jam, and then that will create the induced charge on the pads. So this is the pad plane I shown in this real. You can see the rectangular boxes, rectangular pads of size 5 by 12 mm². So here in this case, XZ position we will get from the pad fired position, and then the Y position, you can, if you measure the drift time, you can get the Y position also. So now you can also calculate how many pads we have in the Z direction, since you know that the pad pitch, this is basically 12 mm², you can just get 75 pads. Now I want to tell, if a track is propagating into the Z direction, we will get 75 pad fire. So we will get at least 75 points to reconstruct a track. Here you can see only 4 points, but if you have the TPC and we have this much of size TPC, then we have we can get many points to reconstruct a track. So now the simulation. Now I told you the geometry. Next step, I told you that we will throw a known particle. So I generated the 10 protons using box generator in C root framework, which is based on square root. I shown the link of the repository. So with these properties, I throw it. So this generally generates the output file, which includes all the track information. Since we know everything about the track, which is stored in the Monte Carlo track branch. And then we have each track have the IDs, and then we have the momentum. And then when a track passes through the volume of the detector, it gives the Monte Carlo point. Before each Monte Carlo point, we can also get the momentum and everything like track ID, and we can match one-to-one which tracks it belongs to. So this is basically the G4 step here. So let's say the most important, you can see for each point, you can also check the X, Y, Z. And then the most important quantity here is the energy loss, which is basically the signal. So in the next step is the digitization, which is basically the discretization. So what I do when a track passes through the, let's say it is a TPC, and then we have jam plane, and then we have the pad plane here. So when a charged particle passes, we have for each Monte Carlo point, we have the electron. We can easily calculate the electron ion pair created, which is just the energy loss divided by the mean energy required to create an electron ion pair. And then what I did, I know the energy loss in this sensitive volume, very small volume. We can distribute these electrons along the track segment, and I distributed these electrons around the track segment. And then you can see here, I distributed, I just, in the code, we distribute like that. And then next step is, as I mentioned, we will drift and diffuse till the jam plane. And then inside the jam, it will make an avalanche, and that will give the induced signal on the pads. So for the drift length, we just take the Y position and the created Y electron or that, and that we know the drift length. And then we parameterize the drift diffusion in the transverse plane. and then the longitudinal in the time direction, we also parameterize. This coefficient we got from the hardware group. They also do the simulation like Garfield plus plus, and they do the testing and they provide these parameters, and I parameterize that way. And then inside, after drift and diffusion, it makes the avalanche. This is again come from the game simulation. This provided again by the hardware design group. And then we used for each avalanche, for each electron, we make an avalanche, and we know the sigma this of the. So then the next, let's say, if it is comes here, the avalanche come here, then it will make Gaussian distribution the inside the gain, and then we know the Gauss. Sigma of the Gaussian, we can easily calculate the fraction of the charge belong this pad. We just integrate this Gaussian on this pad, and then we just add the number of electrons belongs to each pad. And this, and then the next step, since we, these are the number of electrons, we can easily convert into the pulse using the, once we know the single pad response function, we just convert into the ADC. And then finally, we store the fire pad ID, which pad are fired, and the total charge on the pad, total charge on the pads. And then we just also store the time required, because that is used for the bi-coordinate. And then we also store the other things that we, so you can see here, I store these other things. So once we have the pad on the pad fired, and then the charge on the pad, I just saw the simplest case. If you have a, if you got a charge, and if you get a single pad fired, then you will just assign the center position of the pad as the position, and then the resolution is typically can be approximated by pitch by root 12. Basically here is the pad size by root 12, and the. For the many pads, if it is many pad fired, we just use the charge center of gravity using the charge information on each pad. We can reconstruct the position of the track, and then it, in this case, we will get a good improvement, because it's because we are really reconstructing the position of the track, so we get an improvement. And then this is the what we then in whole steps. So first I generated the five protons on the momentum range. So these are the, this gives the Monte Carlo points. And then I do the whole process of that, and I reconstructed the position X reco and Y reco, and also in the Z plane, Z coordinate. So you can see the hit position and the Monte Carlo position is almost matching. And the, in the, also in the Y direction and the Z direction is matching, the hit reconstructed. Next step is, I mentioned, is the calculation of position resolutions, which is basically the reconstructed position minus Monte Carlo position in the X and Y and Z direction. So here I want to mention, I always use the signal over five time bins. This is from, comes from the Sampa chip analysis, where they provided the five time bin signal. This is always we use to convolute it with the electrons response. And then we found the resolution in the X direction is typically 1 millimeter after, and then in the Y direction, because of the time bins is 100 nanosecond, we have a less error in the Y coordinate measurement, which is basically 0.4 millimeter. Next is what we found is, now we check, since we have the pad, we have the angle with the pad. So when a track make angle with theta, so we found some theta dependence on the on the track. If it makes the angle theta, so the resolution is dependent on theta. And also in the Y direction, we found with the Y axis, let's say time axis, the angle, if we take theta Y, then we found some time dependence. So it's increasing with the theta. So this is constant here is because if you have less angle, then whole tracks is inside the single pad. And if you have a little large angle, then you have few pad fire, then you exactly reconstruct the position using the charges, and then you improve the resolution. And then at very large angles, it becomes very wide clusters, and then you don't gain it. So we want to omit this region. So we always want track at zero angle. So we got to the new design in which we have the four sectors, sector zero, sector one, sector two, and sector three. The main idea is that to have the tracks parallel to the pad direction, and we always have this angle is smaller. So we will emit this region of increasing the resolution. And this is what, then I did the, again, the simulation and digitization, heat reconstruction. So this, you can see the blue is the Monte Carlo point, and then the, you can see the pad fired, and I didn't show the reconstructor heat. So you can also see the pad fired position here. So then the next step, once we reconstruct the heat, tracking this, I am working in another framework because here are many other very technical detailed steps. So I am just want to tell how we do. So the reconstructing of the trajectory, basically we need to, now we have the points on the detector plane which we reconstructed from the signal. So that there are two main tasks. One is you have to find that the track finding and the track fitting. This is done by basically the this package GenFit2. So track finding, we will find the track hits belongs to a track candidate. So we will find, first we have to find that hits which belongs to the track, to a track. And this is done by different algorithm, combinatorial, cellular automation, Hug transform. So we are using in that TPC cellular automation, and for the track fitting and the estimation of parameters, we use the Kalman filter. And we have the three steps, chi square per NDF with the main quality, which determines the quality of the track. So this is still in progress, not a very advanced level. It's ongoing work. So we have the six parameters in general, X, Y, Z, PX, PY, PZ, but one is fixed by detector position because we have a Z position of detector as I mentioned before, and or one position is fixed. And in the cylindrical coordinate, we have five parameters. And then the next thing we do, when a track passes through the multiple detector layers, it makes the multiple scattering. So it's when real direction will be like this, but when it passes, it makes the multiple scattering due to the thickness of the material. So you can see when a track passing here, and then it makes the multiple scattering and deflected the initial angle and also shifted the initial position. So this effect you can see from this formula. So theta p depends on the 1 over p momentum and then the also the thickness of the material. So if you have at low momentum, this term will suit. So you're at low momentum, this multiple scattering is dominated by 1 over p. And at the very high momentum, this term becomes very less. And then this becomes the dominated by the thickness of the material. So in general, our track is like this. So what we will do, for the track fitting, now we have the hits basically, which is the measured position shown by the yellow marker. So this is the measured position xi on a plane, xi plus one on the next plane. So let's say we start from the vertex, then we will extrapolate to the next plane in the Kalman filter, which is using the multiple scattering. We know the multiple scattering, how much is the expected here. We will extrapolate on this plane and we have the measured position. Then we will use the weighted average position. For this is known as the Kalman filtered position. And the next step, again, we will extrapolate with using the effect of multiple scattering. On the next plane, we have the measured position. We will use the weighted average position, which is basically called the filtering. And then in the smoothening, we have the filtered values, and we will fit the track with that. So this is what we do in the Kalman filtering. Next, I just want to mention one more thing. So the main output of the tracking, we look for mostly on the PT resolutions, or we look for the momentum resolutions. So in the simplest, PT resolutions has two components. One is due to the arc measurement, another is due to the multiple scattering. Now I just given a simple example. Let's assume the four layers of the silicon is of 300 micrometer thickness, and the real track is shown by the red, and then we have a green due to the multiple scattering. So we have the two effect, due to the curvature measurement, the momentum resolution depends on the position resolution, and then the PT is proportional to the PT divided by B. If we want to reduce this defect for a constant length, we can increase the magnetic field. So here I just plotted for the pion in this case, where P is approximately PT, around eta equals to zero. So I just consider the number of points 4, and then these are the parameters I used here, because 4 points we will get here. And you can also see the multiple scattering angle. At low momentum, you can see that it becomes very large, and at high momentum, when momentum increases, it is dominated by just thickness. It is basically constant. It's not much dependent on momentum. So at low momentum, it's very dependent on the scattering is very large actually. So we have the two component. One is arc, as I mentioned before. So this depends on PT over T. This is ISON for the pions. So you can see that it depends PT by B. So it has a slope at a fixed magnetic field. If we want to decrease it, we can just increase the magnetic field and that will decrease the slope. So that is how we can control this part. Another part is multiple scattering. So this again depends on the error in the coordinate measurement, which is basically depends on the scattering angle. So you can see this effect is shown by the red marker. So at low momentum, because this is increasing, because your beta is small, so then it's increasing. And then at the high momentum, it's constant. So right now, if you see the total momentum resolution in this geometry, so then it comes like this. So it's around 1%. If we want to reduce it, this has less contribution. The most of the contribution is coming from the multiple scattering. So we can reduce the multiple scattering. This can be done by reducing the thickness of the detector. So if we want to reduce this momentum resolution, we have to reduce the thickness of the material, basically thickness of the detector material. So we can reduce it. So this is the how we want the lowest material budget in the detectors, the lowest material budget in the experiment to reduce this the error in the momentum PT measurement. Then the next, the most important thing we look out, suppose we have the vertex position and we have the layers R1 and R2. In this case, we know that D0 requires around from the vertex, from the primary vertex around 123 micrometer. So if we want to measure, let's say if we want to measure the how much minimum we can measure from it, it's typically 1 millimeter. And then if we want to measure this distance, so you should have the resolution in this region of the primary vertex should be less than that, then we can easily tag this D0, otherwise we cannot tag it. So we want the primary vertex resolution as small as possible. So this is the error in the measurement of the impact parameter, which is so this depends on the over R1 over R2 minus R0. So for to improve it, we can simply, we have to reduce, either we can reduce R1 or we can increase R2. So in the LS3, we are going to put this as close as to the this vertex R1, first layer as close as to the primary vertex. So, and some experiment are also putting inside the beam pipe. They are trying to put as close as possible to improve this resolution so that we can reconstruct this D0 and D+ and some other part. So in the upgraded ITS, you can see this, if we will have a great improvement, and you can see if we want to reconstruct T0 around this region, you can also reconstruct because you have less resolution there. Good resolution.
You have 5 minutes.
Yes. Then come to the once we reconstruct the track. Now we have the different methods of particle identification, like DEDX versus momentum. This works for low P region. Then we have a MIP region. Then we have a relativistic rise, and then the separation depends on between the two particle energy loss difference divided by the resolution of the detector energy resolution of detector. Another method, we use the time of flight method, where we measure that the time taken by the particle between two detectors, and the momentum is again measured by the tracking detectors. And then once we know the momentum, we know the time of flight, and then length we know, we can determine the beta, and we can also determine the mass of particle. And the mass square again depends on the resolution, the width of the peak depends on the momentum resolutions, the time resolution and length resolution. Another method is also, we have this Cherenkov method, where we again measure the Cherenkov angle of the emitted photons. From Cherenkov angle, we can determine the beta, and momentum we can determine by tracking tracker, and then we can determine the mass of the particle. This is how we determine the mass of the particle. Then we can, once we know the PI, once we have PID, we can reconstruct the secondary particle like D0 reconstruction. So using the combination of the identified particles, we can reconstruct it. So in the simulation, if we do this in this work, we call this physics performance, and it, in the real data, we call it physics data analysis. So we, when we do the detector simulation, we code the physics performance, and then we also do the other analysis also. And then what I explained before, it just the chain goes like this: simulation, we just have event generation, and then the transport, and then the digitization, heat reconstruction, and the tracking, and then we evaluate the physics performance. But in the real data, we have the realistic collisions, so we don't have these steps. We have just the charge on the pads, and then we reconstruct the heat position and the tracking and physics analysis. This is, and then I go to the summary for my plan. So in the realistic proton-proton collision, how it will look like in the once we have proton-proton collisions in the simulation, we will generate with Pythia, and then we have this whole chance of hard QCD interaction whole process, and then we have in the final state, we have the stable primary particle which we propagate by using the GIANT. We use basically G4 particle gun to propagate these produced particles, and then we do the digitization, then we do the, this is the whole steps of the simulation. But in the real PP collisions, we will just have the charge on the pads, or we convert into ADC, and then we have the heat reconstruction, then we do the tracking, and then we do the physics analysis. So I would say that detector simulation in the realistic environment is very, it includes so many steps. So we expect, so it's very complex. So then it includes the generator side complexity as well as the detector side complexity. This is all. Thank you.